So since February now, we've been taking a lot of time to explore our guiding values here at the center. And just a quick note, if you've missed any of those and you would like to go back, there is a page under our About system with all our About section on the website with all of our guiding values listed out. There's little links to essays. So if you are like, oh, I'd kind of like to go back, I missed a few, you can explore all of that there. But for today, we're going to continue our exploration of our guiding value known as non-duality, where both and expands our awareness of God and others and the world around us. And so we began talking about non-duality last week. And when we did that, we noted that while either or thinking can sometimes feel comforting, right? It's this thing or that thing. It can also cause us a little bit of stress because it's just so limited. It doesn't explore possibility. And so that's where this notion of both and can be helpful. It can allow us to experience all of that possibility and more connection. And it can help us see maybe what we weren't able to see when we felt forced into those either or paradigms. And so to continue offering examples of how this can look in our lives and why it can be so helpful, as it turns out, non-duality can help us develop an ability to hold things in tension. So there's this woman, Cynthia Borgholt. She's an Episcopalian priest. She's a colleague of Richard Rohr's. And she connects this ability to hold things in tension to the spiritual practice of letting go. And so when she talks about that, she often cites this verse that comes from a letter that Paul wrote to the people of Philippi. So in Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 through 7, we hear, though his, and his being Jesus, so though Jesus's state was that of God, yet he did not deem equality with God something that he could cling to. Rather, he emptied himself, and assuming the state of a slave, he was born in human likeness. So Paul here, as he's reflecting on the life of Jesus, he considers, what allowed Jesus to say yes to laying his life down as he did? And as Paul thinks about that, as Paul receives revelation from the Holy Spirit, he concludes Jesus didn't focus on his status. He didn't focus on what he was entitled to, what he should get. And so in other words, Jesus didn't cling to his identity, this thing that we hear in that passage. Instead, Jesus lets it go. Or said this other way that we're hearing in this translation, Jesus empties himself. And so from Paul's perspective, to live in a Christ-like way, at least in part, involves letting things go. It involves engaging in this self-emptying process. And Paul points all of this out in order to help us with those struggles of the mind, because Paul knows it's a human nature type of a thing to cling to things like ideals, things, narratives. We like to cling to our stories and the things that we like and the way that we think things should be. So all of this clinging to thoughts and shoulds, it ultimately forces us, ironically, into small definitions, small identities, either or thinking, which we're told it's ultimately at the root of our suffering. It keeps us kind of locked in small places. So could Jesus have said, I'm either a king or I'm not? Sure, right? Like that could have been the story. But that identity, you would think an identity as a king is maybe kind of expansive, kind of a good thing. But that identity wasn't as expansive as being a friend to all, a shepherd, a light, a human. The meaning and purpose in Jesus's life was infinitely more when he could be both a king and all of these other things. And so the same is true for us. When we become Christ-like in our thinking, we put on the mind of Christ, sometimes it's called, we let go. we empty ourselves of things having to be exactly one way or another. We release it and we enter into that more expansive both and non-dualistic way of thinking and way of being. And this begins to help our lives to feel spacious. And so maybe I'll just stop there for a moment. As you hear about this notion, this spiritual practice of letting go, of not clinging, maybe take a moment to consider. Do you have examples of your own where, oh yeah, I see how clinging has actually been unhelpful to me, that did not serve me? What has helped you in developing an ability to hold things in tension? Or is there something else that you think about? So I would love to open the floor. I'll just give you another moment with these questions here. Examples of clinging that have occurred in your own life, or what helps you hold things in tension, or what else do you think about? So as we keep going, it turns out there are other reasons for why non-duality can be helpful to us. In addition to developing this ability to hold things in tension, as you'll see here on the screen, non-duality helps us accept the difficulties in life. So kind of similar vein, but that need to be able to do that. So even just this week, I was realizing how easily I compare myself to other people. I easily but not helpfully judge myself, something that we've already started talking about here. Like if I take a break in my day, I think, oh my gosh, somehow taking a break is bad. Like I'm not working hard enough. My efforts won't pan out, the whole bit. And so it's always this like kind of background urge to keep working as if that's the answer. All of these struggles, you know, whatever each of us has will be unique. We'll all have our own version of what that means for us. But generally speaking, we live in this culture where we constantly push and we constantly strive and we try to bend outcomes to match our desire. And this is a place where engaging non-duality, utilizing spiritual practice can be helpful, because without spaciousness, without connecting to that inner wisdom, like it's difficult to get in touch with those alternatives. It's difficult to get in touch to that prompting of the Holy Spirit and to being able to accept things as they actually are. And so one spiritual practice that can help is really simply just to rest, sort of like that notion of going and taking a walk. But Jesus talks about it, at least at one point, like this in Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." And so maybe it's worth drawing attention to that resting in Jesus is different from other sorts of practices. Sometimes when we think about Jesus, we might think of asking for things or praising, and those are also good and they are also spiritual practices. It's just that the experience of resting is this act of not working. We rest in order to replenish ourselves. It's very different from trying to solve things. But at the same time, it's interesting to realize that what many people notice is that while they are sitting there resting or walking and resting or whatever it is, not working, not solving, that things somehow get done anyways. And in fact, there's this book called Wild Mercy. It's written by Mirabai Starr. The entire second chapter is about the practice of rest. And I should tell you, because I'm about to read a quote from it, she refers to the divine feminine throughout the chapter. So she speaks of God as feminine. And so if that is kind of like, that doesn't really work for me, I can't see it that way, feel free to translate to something that does work for you. But I do find how she talks about rest here to be relatable. And so I wanted to share her words with you. She says this: gather your burdens in a basket in your heart. Set them at the feet of the mother. Say, take this, great mama, because I cannot carry all this for another minute. And then crawl into her broad lap and nestle against her ample bosom and take a nap. When you wake, the basket will still be there, but half of its contents will be gone, and the other half will have resumed their ordinary shapes and sizes, no longer masquerading as catastrophic, epic, chronic, and toxic. The mother will clear things out and tidy up. She will take your compulsions and transmute them, but only if you freely offer them to her. So I find this to be such a beautiful picture of what it might look like to follow the words of Jesus, to come to him when we feel weary and burdened. And so I would love to open the floor for discussion again, just to kind of ask ourselves, do I relate to needing help in order to accept the difficulties of life? Or maybe how do I navigate trying to have a moment by moment relationship with God? Or is there something else? How do these inclinations strike us?